Hi everyone, and welcome to our channel. In this episode, I'd like to show you a rather interesting and unique way to create tileable textures. Not just any tileable textures, but ones that from the software say they're not tileable. But before we get to that, I'd like to go back and revisit an item from a previous episode. You may remember I showed how to create parametric designs. After the episode aired, I received a comment mentioning that part of how I created the vectors was unclear. So I thought, let me at least show a clearer version of how you can draw the vectors to create your parametric designs. This is the original video that you may remember. I have a link in my description to this previous video of how to make parametric designs. And as you can see, I do it rather quickly with a lot of guidelines. And I would have to say, yes, I'm not quite as clear as it should be. So I want to take this opportunity to maybe show a cleaner version, a more understandable version of how to create these vectors. With that in mind, I'm going to open a new session of my Aspire software, and I'm going to import one of the 3D clipart models that comes with the software. The bass, for example. I resize it as need be, not unlike the raindrops that we saw previously in our example. And to utilize the model cross section, click on the drawing tab, click on the icon for measure, and at the bottom it says model cross section. You can click anywhere you want and drag your cursor down to where you want it to end. It will always be a straight line except when it crosses the 3D model. Now, my drawing style is that I usually swing my vector or my cursor out to the right and bring it back into the left until it snaps. If you can draw it straight through, the better you are. This is just happens to be my style of drawing. I hide my 3D component, and those are the vectors that I've created. I can click on one of them, enter into the node editing mode, hover over a span and hit the D key, the top and the bottom, vectors are deleted, and I join the remaining open vector with a straight line. That's all there is to it. And you would do that for each successive vector that you've created over your 3D model. Interestingly, while I was doing this, I thought to myself, well, does the vector have to be vertical? I tried creating model cross sections on a slant, and it does work. Now, I'm going to have to try this on my own machine later on, and I'll report back to you. But that's the process of using the model cross section. I hope that was a little clearer. So, now onto the topic at hand, creating tileable textures. It's an odd little process that I've learned a long time ago. In fact, it's a process I learned while I was learning Photoshop. And since Photoshop deals with images, JPEGs and bitmaps and grayscales, I learned that I can apply this same technique to the Vectric software, specifically Aspire. I go to my clipart tab, and under the folders, you have three subfolders: a texture area tiles, a texture fill tiles, and a textures not tileable. That's the folder we want to open up. Let's just assume you have a customer that loves this design and wants it to go wrap around a room 30 lineal feet, but would love to have 12 inch long and 6 inch high squares doubled up. So it winds up being a 12 inch tall by 24 inch wide area duplicated over and over and over again. I take my component that I've imported, size it down to the size that I want, 12 inch wide, 6 inch tall. And my first step is to create a rectangle the size of my workspace, 24 by 12. I use this simply for the alignment tool. I click on my component, click on my rectangle, and I tell the software, put my component in the top left-hand corner by choosing the correct icons in the alignment tool. I'm going to duplicate that component, changing the property of both of the new components to merge. And I'm going to take my second component now and move it over to the top right-hand side, simply by using, again, the alignment tools. A word of caution, when you use this method sometimes of alignment, you might find there's a little space in between each of the components. So, using your arrow keys and one of the components highlighted, move it over slightly. The fact that the property is set to merge, it won't matter if they overlap ever so slightly. And once you have them positioned to where you're comfortable, we're going to duplicate these two components. And move them below the original two. So in our 24 inch wide by 12 inch tall space, we're going to have four individual components. Again, we zoom in to make sure there's no space between the upper components and the lower components. Now, as you can see, this really is not a tileable texture, so the software is correct. These are non-tileable textures. Let me show you how you can make it tileable. I'm going to take one of the components and duplicate it. Since they're all the same, it doesn't matter which one it is. And I'm going to move that new component to a new level. And just like before, I'm going to click on my component and click on my rectangle and move to the upper left quadrant. Component, rectangle, upper left quadrant. Here's now the trick of how you can make non-tileable textures tileable. I'm going to draw a straight vertical vector, and I'm going to center it within my component. Utilizing the alignment tools. Once it's centered, I click on my vector and click on my component, and I'm going to use the scissors to cut it apart. Now I have a left and a right component. I take my vector, rotate it 90 degrees, make sure that it's in the center of the components, again, the alignment key, and I'm going to now cut the right-hand side apart, and I'm going to do the same with the left-hand component. So I've cut this component into four pieces. Top left, top right, bottom left, bottom right. Here's the process.
So, with my four components selected, I create a bounding vector around those. I delete my horizontal vector.
We're going to change positions of these components. I want to take my top left component and move it and exchange it with the bottom right. I'm going to do the same with the other ones. I'm going to take my bottom left and exchange it with the top right. Sounds confusing, but it really isn't. All you're doing is swapping positions. Watch how easy it is.
I start with my top left, move it out of the way, take my bottom right, and using the alignment tools, move it to its first position, which is the top left. I take the component I moved out of the way and move it into the bottom right corner. I do the same thing with the other two components. Move one out of the way, take my top right, move it to the bottom left. And the extra one put into the top right hand corner. The alignment tools work really well.
We're almost done. The most important aspect of this is the edge, the total perimeter edge of this component. I'm going to make a model of these four component parts. So now I'm dealing with a singular component, and I need to go in and do a little sculpting on the interior seams of where the components were. It's not a hard process, it's rather quick and easy. Go in with a little bit of the smudge tool. Be careful not to get too close to the edge. That edge is very, very critical not to be disturbed. And since this is natural texture, there's no right or wrong thing. All you want to do is eliminate any vertical or horizontal line, any indication of anything rigid, like a straight line. You can increase the size or the strength of your smudge tool. So this part of the sculpting is in real time. I didn't speed up the video. It's just as easy as this. Eliminate any possible view of a straight line. There's not much for the horizontal, but I'm going to just change a little bit of the texture so that that horizontal line doesn't become apparent. And once you're done, that's the component you're going to be working with. Just like in previous examples, I'm going to make three additional copies of it and locate them in the top right-hand quadrant, the bottom left-hand quadrant, and the bottom right-hand quadrant, aligning them as need be, making sure that there's no space between each of the components. Simply click on the component and use your arrow key to nudge it over slightly. I usually nudge both of them, one in one direction and the opposite one in the other direction. They move closer to the center of my workspace. Making duplicate copies of those two components. And moving them below the original two. And if we take a look at it, click off the components, There's our four individual components in a now tileable scenario. Four individual components. This could be done with almost any of the non-tileable textures within the software. Again, this is the original, non-tileable. Obviously, it's not tileable. And this is my version of how it could be made into a tileable component, which you can make as many as you want and wrap around. I took each of these components and gave it a different property, a wood type. So you can actually see there are four different components, but they match up rather easily. So I hope this little Photoshop trick can help you out making some interesting tileable textures when you thought you couldn't. I'd love to see your end results if you try this out. It could add a lot to your bag of tricks. Textures are a very hot topic. If you'd like to learn more about the software, subscribe to our channel and don't forget to click on the bell to be reminded of our new videos. And of course, as always, if you need help, send me an email. mm@mezalick.com. I'll be glad to help. Thanks for watching. See you next time. Enjoy.